Today, I'm going to take my first ever scuba dive in the world's first national shark sanctuary. To get to the action, it's a short but very fast boat ride through the lagoon and past the beautiful limestone rock islands. Dermot Keane, the dive shop manager who's been lobbying for a sanctuary for years, can't wait to get in the water.
You know, I've worked on this for almost 8 years, and I've had many, many dives in Palau and many, many dives with sharks, but this is going to be my very, very first dive in the new sanctuary that was declared by President Terribiong.
There's even a chance we may see a marlin swimming by on the surface.
My instructor, Jim Wilkie, is also coming along to make sure I'm okay.
So, Dave, when we hit the water, I'll try to get in just as quick as you. We're going to keep the wall on the right and the sharks on the left. Any questions, comments, concerns?
No chance of me getting eaten here?
Well, Dave, if it would, it would be the first time it's ever happened in Palau. We put hundreds of thousand divers in the water on a yearly basis, and has not one time anyone been eaten by a shark. But you could be the first. Okay, guys, let's go diving.
Right. Okay, all good. Tuck that in there.
This dive site is known as Blue Corner. Dermot Keane leads the way into the abyss. The ocean floor is over 300 meters below us. We work our way along the wall to the edge of the drop-off. Palauan diving is famous for the coral hook, which allows you to hang suspended in the upsurging current. A 130 species of shark live in and visit Palau's waters, but today we see mostly grey reef and white tip sharks. Although there have been no formal studies on Palau's shark population, Dermot Keane is convinced the numbers are falling.
You know, the frequency of seeing some of the other sharks, oceanic white tips, silkies, threshers, some of the other sharks that tend to be, you know, more offshore, that's definitely diminished over the years.
And it's no wonder. These photos show just a fraction of the total number of sharks caught illegally in Palau, part of an estimated 100 million sharks killed worldwide each year. Amidst the carnage, Palau's president, Johnson Toribiong, came up with a plan and took it to the United Nations.
The physical strength and beauty of sharks are a natural barometer for the health of our oceans. Therefore, I declare today that Palau will become the world's first national shark sanctuary, ending all commercial shark fishing in our waters and giving a sanctuary for sharks to live and reproduce unmolested in our 2,000 plus square miles of ocean. We call upon all nations to join us.
But not every country feels as generous towards these magnificent creatures. As the middle class in neighboring Asia grows, so does demand for shark fin soup, a symbol of status and wealth. Palau's president has first-hand experience of the role the famous dish plays from his time as ambassador to Taiwan.
If you're a guest of honor, they give you a bowl of shark fin soup, which I enjoyed.
What will you say to your hosts the next time you're in Taiwan and they offer you a bowl of shark fin soup?
I will tell them, excuse me, I became the champion of the preservation of sharks, and I have taken a vow not to eat any piece of shark or even to enjoy a bowl of shark fin soup. Thank you very much. Let's have a bowl of chicken soup.
Declaring Palau's waters a shark sanctuary is one thing, actually enforcing it another. Their one patrol boat is meant to cover 600,000 square kilometres of ocean, an area larger than France. Palau's representative at the United Nations, Stuart Beck, knows it's an enormous challenge.
The ways and means are yet to be determined. We have problems with surveillance, problems with the capacity to arrest. Palau is a hot spot for piracy, and it's very difficult to operate under these circumstances, but somebody has to show the way.
How do they say it? A journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step.
I join the president as he drops in on the patrol boat, which was donated by the Australian government.
Is this the first time you've been on board?
Yes, my very first time on this patrol boat. So I'm with Captain Albert.
Yeah.
Who is an Australian trained pilot.
Palau's marine police are trained in Launceston.
In Tasmania, that's way down south, right? Yeah.
Unfortunately, patrols are rare. Apparently, because the government can't afford the fuel.
To protect the waters, we're going to initiate or launch a more aggressive surveillance program in Palau. But that needs resources, so we're going to work to find money to support our shark sanctuary.
Without the resources to properly patrol Palau's waters, the policing is mostly land-based.
Inspection of the
inspection?
Today, the authorities are checking returning boats for evidence of shark fishing. But I'm told these searches don't happen frequently enough to properly monitor illegal activities.
They have marlin, sharkfish.
But the culprits don't even bring the illegal haul to port here, instead transferring it to huge motherships which skirt around the edge of Palau's new sanctuary.
We know from some other data from, you know, law enforcement and other agencies that they are indeed transshipping these things offshore, which also is a violation of their license agreement. So not only are they just taking sharks, but they're also, there are other species, and they're denying Palau, you know, revenue from, the proper revenue from the fish that they are indeed licensed to catch.
The crew on these Taiwanese-owned boats are mostly Filipino and Indonesian.
Ikan hiu ada di mana?
Ada.
Nyimpan-nyimpan?
Hah? Nggak ada.
Nggak ada. Ada di mana? Di bawah di sini ya?
Di kantong.
Kantong.
These boats are longliners, which, as the name suggests, set their baits on lines kilometres long.
This would be the main line.
Devastating the marine environment.
With these hooks out there, they're catching sharks and turtles and rays, even sometimes seabirds and so forth. So, you know, it's an indiscriminate practice. It catches everything. It causes a lot of bycatch, and including sharks, even if they're not intentionally focusing on them. And in some cases, they're even catching seabirds. So it really does a lot of damage.
In an effort to help Palau get a sense of the scale of the problem, the Australian government organised a surveillance flight over Palau's waters last year.
They discovered about 70 fishing vessels fishing in our waters. Many of them were illegal.
You know, the Australian government was kind enough to have a flyover in which they reported, but that kind of periodic flyover is of no use. We obviously need daily information, geosynchronous information from satellites, which indicate what boats are in our waters and whether their vessel monitors are on. And, you know, this area needs to be policed. And there's a question about who's going to roll up their sleeves and do it.
The more time I spend down here, I realize the task of policing the world's first shark sanctuary is huge. And I'm starting to wonder whether the concept is just a clever tourism marketing campaign. It's certainly working on me. By the end of my first amazing dive, I'm sold on the sanctuary idea.
And it's not just a symbolic effort. Palau needs assistance in enforcing this sanctuary, there's no question about it. But I think one of the first things that's incumbent, you know, before you start asking others for help, you have to help yourself. I think Palau has made it very, very clear that when we do have these laws, the world has been put on notice. Our friends with whom we have diplomatic relations, other countries including Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, you know, they're on notice too, that, you know, these are our resources and we shall protect them. So protection and enforcement of this shark sanctuary is indeed the next challenge.
The last time the patrol boat went out, it showed what can be achieved. These photos show police closing in on a Taiwanese longliner. They're caught red-handed with hundreds of pieces of shark on board. The captain faces 108 charges. His boat is impounded, and the crew, who have not been charged, spend their days waiting for news on when they can leave.
Kita cuma kerja, Pak. Gak ada omongan dari majikan bahwa ini negara Palau, lautan Palau. Kita gak ada omongan kayak gitu. Jadi kita gak menyangka, kita bakalan tertangkap di Palau.
Tapi memang mencari ikan hiu.
Ya.
This is the first case to come up since the announcement at the UN, and I'm shocked to hear from the president himself that the matter may not even make it through the courts. He says that jailing people and impounding boats is just too costly.
Sometimes if you try to push the case to the point where the law is enforced to the max, we don't get anything.
But later he brings it up again. He seems concerned that I've raised the matter with him.
By the way, going back to the case, I am now thinking about requiring the government not to plea bargain any case involving shark fishing and shark finning, but to prosecute every case to the max.
So you just had a policy change on the run.
Well, I'm thinking about that right now. I look into the law to make sure that maybe we'll raise the fines higher, require forfeiture, and requires no plea bargain.
Because the impounded boat is Taiwanese, this is tricky for Palau. After all, Taiwanese money built the grand structure the president now sits in. The building next door is the judiciary, but the president's next admission would appear to make a mockery of Palau's legal system.
If you catch a boat from a country that's friendly to Palau, sometimes the diplomatic relations would, so to speak, compromise the aggressiveness of the prosecutors or the government to enforce the law.
But that particular case is almost a test of your reputation,
yes,
and commitment on this issue.
Not so much my reputation, but Palau's reputation, so I'll look into it.
Palau's magnificent waters are world famous amongst divers. The president's younger brother was recently inducted into the International Scuba Diving Hall of Fame.
Is that the boat which you arrested?
He was one of the people who convinced the president to declare a shark sanctuary. No small irony, given that Johnson Torabiong was once an attorney for the Taiwanese longliners.
Many times. Sometimes they catch sharks illegally. Sometimes they catch tuna illegally.
Mm-hmm. So it's a remarkable transformation for a man who used to defend the interests of the shark fishermen to somebody who's made the complete turnaround, as you have.
Yes, it really makes no difference to me, because when I was a defense attorney, I took an oath to defend my clients to the best of my ability. Now that I'm the president, I represent all of the people of Palau. And I have an obligation to protect and preserve our resources. So I approach my job with the same zeal and vigor.
For the sake of future generations, let's hope he's successful. Shark preservation is now well and truly on the curriculum, featuring Finny the shark.
Hey, save the shark!
Save the shark!
Save Finny!
Have you ever eaten shark?
Yes.
It's very good. Is it?
Yeah.
Will you still be eating shark?
No.